All right, everybody. We're going to get started. Before Cornel addresses us all, I just want to have a couple of thank yous to go through really quickly. So first off, Soha Mahmoud, who is the founder of the Muslim Student Association here at St. Francis, is the reason we're here. She helped us get the space. She was instrumental in making sure that we were able to use it, and you know, we had what we needed. So if everyone could just give her a round of applause. She can't be here. We want to thank the St. Francis staff. They did an amazing job of helping us out and making sure this event ran really smoothly. Then I want to thank the coordinating committee from YDS. They were an amazingly helpful group, making sure everyone got here, that we had a program that was worthwhile, and that we had something to do during the weekend. I also want to thank Maria. She was great making sure we had food, getting everyone here, made sure it happened. Finally, I do want to thank everyone for coming. These conferences are kind of useless unless people show up, so without you, it's kind of a waste of time. All right. So then, without further ado, I'm going to introduce Dr. West. Dr. West is a champion of racial justice since childhood. He is one of the most America's provocative public intellectuals. As writing, speaking, and teaching weaves together traditions of the Black Baptist Church, progressive politics, and jazz. Currently the class of 1943 professor at Princeton University, Dr. West burst onto the national scene in 1993 with his best-selling book, Race Matters, a searing analysis of racism in American democracy. Race Matters has become a contemporary classic, selling more than 500,000 copies to date. In West's long awaited life story, Brother West, Living Out Loud, he offers a compelling exploration of his heart behind the human mind. Themes include faith, family, philosophy, love, and service. And Dr. West has published 19 other books and has edited 13 texts. He's an honorary co-chair of the Democratic Socialists of America. He's also going to be speaking on a panel with Barbara Einrich and Francis Fox Piven, who are also DSA chairs at the Left Forum. There's a flyer outside. You should come check it out. And all three of them are going to be at a meet and greet afterwards. So it'd be great to see you all there. Without that, I'm going to introduce them. Let them go.
Thanks so much. That one's not working.
This one seems like it's working though.
Oh, so that's wonderful.
I think it's best for me just to be able to walk around because I like to stay in movement.
That's enough for
you. There we go. First, I want to begin by acknowledging visionary leadership, Brother Andrew. Give him a hand. Give him a hand. We thank you, Brother Andrew. We love and respect you. Send this up to Sister Maria. Sister Maria, give her a hand. We love and respect you indeed. I know Brother Sanchez, Brother Victor Sanchez is in the house. Give him a hand, he's President of the U.S. Student Association, L.A., now Washington, D.C. And I want to give each and every one of you a hand, because I tell you, I come in a spirit of deep humiliation. I pay tribute to the fact that it has been young brothers and sisters of all colors and cultures and civilizations from Northern Africa, Greece, Spain, Italy, occupying Wall Street, occupying Tallahassee, occupying Omaha. You all have been really on the cutting edge. So let me just give you a hand. But I'm not going to allow you to clap for yourself. Indeed. Brother Joseph Schwartz know what I'm talking about. We go back 30 years now. Isn't it something that you got a little gray and I got more coming? But we joined DSA in 1982, and we were blessed, of course, to be there with our dear brother Michael Harrington. We love him very much. We'll never forget him. This is the 50th year, you all know, the other America, focusing on poverty. He began as a Catholic activist under the visionary Dorothy Day, lost his faith and gained even more political activism. Fascinating. And ended up a towering figure. And it's 30 years later that we find ourselves in this moment, the age of Occupy. I want to acknowledge the presence of my brother Luther and Sister Margaret, who came all the way from Philadelphia. They've got a little more gray than I do. Give both of them a hand as well. A little more gray than I do. More handsome, more beautiful, a little more gray, a little more gray. But I come actually just to learn and listen from you all. You see, I'm old school. Old school means, in fact, that you try to cultivate the capacity of receptivity. And the capacity capacity, receptivity is to learn how to receive. It's an active process. It's a very active process. But oftentimes as you get older and older and older, you almost assume that because you've been around for so long, that you have more to offer than others, and that's just not simply the truth. And if you're going to be a long-distance runner in the struggle for freedom and justice and equality, there has to be a way in which whatever forms of arrogance you have are shattered and called into question. So I come to you in the spirit of sharing, but most importantly, I want to be able to learn and listen from you all. I am very excited about this wave of activism that's going to take place in a few weeks. I can't wait until spring hits. I just was in California yesterday, so spring has already hit. 75 degrees in Fresno yesterday. Los Angeles had almost 80. I was there just a few days ago on Monday, so that spring is already hitting. But when it hits Chicago, Detroit, New York, when it hits in Ohio, in Kentucky, Kansas, I know we got our sister from Kansas here. There she is, Sister Jackie. Oh yes, absolutely. Give Sister Jackie a hand. All the way from Kansas, Co-Chair. I can't wait for this new wave. I know student debt is going to be one of the fundamental focuses. Crucial. Crucial, but it's going to be connected to a variety of other issues. I was just in court 2 days ago for the Stop and Frisk movement here in New York City. You all know about that movement, Stop and Frisk, and 700,000, nearly 700,000, 87% black and brown youth, less than 10% are arrested, and they're trying to defend that, saying it's basically a matter of enforcement of the law rather than arbitrary police power being used and deployed in poor communities, disproportionately black and brown. And we're going to have a big court case April the 30th. And that's going to be a part and parcel of this new wave. We're going to be hitting a variety of different issues. And there's no doubt that Democratic Socialists of America and a variety of different radical activists, because one of the most important things, I think, in any moment of social movement is that you have a heterogeneous group, which means you'll be bouncing up against some anarchists. Because anytime things are on the move, anarchist brothers and sisters are going to be there. That's fine with me. We have some ideological differences, but you still bounce up against them. You're going to bounce up against some communists. They're red and I'm pink, but that's all right. I'm a democratic socialist. I'm pink. I'm not red, but you bounce up against some red. And y'all spend a lot of time with Carl Dix, Revolutionary Communist Party. Got some deep disagreements. But when it comes to fighting on the domestic front, they're part of the only going to bounce up against some liberals who are upset. Now that bouncing is not always a reciprocal one, because if they're deferential to oligarchs, deferential to plutocrats, deferential imperial occupation and invasion, then you got very deep disagreements. But they can still have a passion for justice on particular issues. And when you're dealing with student debt, you might find yourself bouncing up against some Ron Paul brothers and sisters. Right? Ron Paul stumbles on the truth sometimes, doesn't he? I'm a libertarian. I do believe in the preciousness of rights and liberties. I'm with Ron Paul trying to do away with the Patriotic Act. When he talks about empire, not in the same way, but he uses the language. Oh, that's a move even better than neoliberal sometimes. So you have to have an open mind, even as you have your own sense of who you are. And that's what I want to begin with very briefly, defining who you are. As you can imagine, that I know many of you, but myself, I'm still wrestling with the death of Sister Whitney. I'm going to be very honest with you. Because Whitney Houston did mean a lot to me. Because I'm a soul man. That's my tradition. See, if black music wasn't for black music, I'd be in jail right now. I would have hurt somebody. No doubt about that. Whitney's just a moment. Like Louis Armstrong and Sarah Vaughan, John Coltrane, Curtis Mayfield, Gil Scott Heron, all the way up to Lupe Fiasco, Chuck D. These are not just entertainers for me. Now, I heard about that human power last night. which means the music means something to you all too. So when you're talking about defining who you are, it's a matter of trying to locate your traditions. When I talk about finding who I am, I'm trying to locate my tradition. How do I want to be a decent person in the move from my mother's womb to tomb? What kind of human being do you want to be? You're not here that long. That cuts deeper than politics. It cuts deeper than ideology. It has to do with fundamental human decency, fundamental human integrity. And if you want to live a life of decency and integrity, you decide, I am concerned about those who are suffering. I'm concerned about the politically weak and the economically vulnerable, and I'm going to do something about it. And I want to be a long distance runner. I don't want to come out strong in the blocks, sprinting, and lo and behold, run out of gas when I'm 29. And you're running the phone. Weren't you at that magnificent weekend in St. Francis, the young socialist gathering? Yes. Well, what are you doing now? Well, I've become well adjusted to injustice. I fit in now. I'm doing very well. I'm very successful. I got a lot of material toys. Look at my trophy spouse. Oh, you're selling your soul for a mess of pottage, huh? You gave up. You caved in, huh? You weren't able to be a long distance runner. That brother, me and Brother Swartz know what we talk about. We had a whole lot of folks came out of the block strong in 82. Been on Wall Street since 1992. And they're still human beings. I'm not trashing them. I don't believe in demonizing. I believe in harshly criticizing. And you try to do it in love, right? Because people can change. People wake up at different times, and they can go back to sleep and wake up again. Or they can go back to sleep and stay asleep for a long time, because there's a lot of seductions and temptations when you're sleepwalking, as it were. One of the great things of your generation is you all are shattering the sleepwalking. It's like that first line of Henry David Thoreau's Wall in that classic in American radicalism. What can I do to awake my neighbors from their sleepwalking? I'm going to the pond. Walden, I'm going to jail against the Mexican War. I'm going to bear witness. But for you all especially, in terms of defining who you are, it is important to accent the intellectual dimension. It's not just a matter of being an activist, but you learn how to think for yourself. Great Malcolm X used to say in every speech, think for yourself, listen for yourself, and speak for yourself as you are in solidarity with those Frantz Fanon called the wretched of the earth. Now, my own traditions, soul sensibility is a matter of finding your own voice. That's the anthem of black people in America, right? It's lift every voice. It doesn't say lift every echo. What is magnificent about your generation is you all are finding your voices the way blues women and jazz men do. You're refusing to be an echo. And this is a major challenge because a market-driven society trying to convince us just to be stimulated and titillated, trying to get us to become conformists to their materialistic way of life so that somehow we just fit in with some managerial professional slot as if it's all about career rather than your calling, as if it's about profession rather than your vocation, or as if it's about just finding a job as opposed to what is your life task, what kind of person do you want to be. The issue of finding voice is central. It's a matter in part of thinking critically. I call it the Socratic moment. Because like Socrates, you want to think about who you are, how you've been shaped, what traditions and narratives and stories you're going to be a part of, and what kind of legacy you want to leave when you die. But you don't know when you drop dead. Our generation, we had Jimi Hendrix gone at 27, Jim Morrison gone at 27, Janis Joplin gone at 27. He left legacy. Rich legacy. So what do I mean by intellectual? Well, one is, what kind of analysis will you have of yourself, society, and the world? The variety of different traditions. If you keep track of the suffering of poor people, of working people, you keep track of the suffering of people of color, keep track of the suffering of precious gay brothers and lesbian sisters, keep track of the suffering of the widows, the elderly, keep track of the suffering of the precious and priceless children here and around the world. What kind of intellectual weaponry will you have? The issues of class now central. That's a rare thing in American history. We have to sustain that focus, but always connected to gender and race, sexual orientation, and empire, so we can make the connections between Wall Street oligarchs and plutocrats. You all know about the 1% on 42% of the wealth, the top 400 individuals having wealth equivalent to the bottom 150 million citizens. Something sick about that. It's not just wrong, it's sick. Given the shortness of life and the preciousness of life. But that connection between Wall Street oligarchs and plutocrats, what is it? 1970s, banks had 8% of the profits, today they got 41%. That's called the financialization of the capitalist economy. It's a global affair. It's a global affair. But there's a connection between that in the economic sphere and then tied to the new Jim Crow. Michelle Alexander, you all know Sister Michelle's book, right? Michelle Alexander's book, Necessary Reading, Imperative Reading. She was kind enough to have me write the foreword for the paperback, and it's now number 5 on the New York Times bestseller list. Can you imagine a book about the prison industrial complex that Angela Davis and so many others have been talking about for the last 25 and 30 years, number 5? Sister Michelle Alexander's on the move. We've got to make sure that her voice, alongside others, are part of this spring offensive, because when we talk about young people, we want young folk across the board. They're in prison, outside of prison. They're in vanilla suburbs and chocolate cities, the red reservation, the brown barrios, yellow neighborhoods. Universal, but still keeping track of that fundamental issue of class and class inequality. It's very difficult in the history of this nation to sustain that. And yet that is what gift of your generation has been. This is why this is a moment of Occupy. We want to make it an age of Occupy. We want to make it so hip for young folk to be part of the Occupy movement that you can't even have a love affair unless you're making some contribution to the Occupy. Well, that's what it was when I was coming along. So 1960, we had the dances, and the sisters wouldn't even dance with you unless you met their criteria of being an activist in the black struggle. So, oh yeah, I was reading Huey last night, baby. Me and Bobby Seale had a dialogue in my dream. Like, come on, can I dance? Come on, let's. Now, I'm not saying we have to be authoritarian about this thing, but it's part of the culture. It's part of the culture. It becomes so normal to be active and politically conscious that you become marginal if you are indifferent to the suffering of others, insensitive to the suffering of others. It's been the opposite for the last 35 years. We live in an ice age where it's fashionable to be indifferent to the suffering of others. It's been about the lives of the rich and famous. It's been about just a matter of title, wealth, position. I think of this movie, The Social Network. God, I went to see that thing on New York Times. And said, oh, this is a movie about the triumph of the human spirit. I said, oh, I got to check this out. This one. I like the triumph of the human spirit. It could be no matter who it is. I went to see that movie. I said, God, you all got a chance to see that? Oh, Lord. Money, 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 Benjamin, Benjamin, Benjamin's women as object of sexual conquest, the word deployed here and there. I said, this is a form of spiritual malnutrition. Emptiness of the soul reminds me of one of the Greek plays that were written about America called The Iceman Cometh by Eugene O'Neill, our genius Irish brother. Try to possess your soul by means of possessing commodities. And that moral, that spiritual malnutrition is inseparable from moral constipation. Folks have a sense of what's right, but it's stuck and it won't come out. It won't flow. It's too much greed, too much avarice, too much envy, too much jealousy. How, in fact, do we open ourselves, become vulnerable enough, and muster the courage to think critically from the vantage point of those catching hell, of those below? And it means you're going to cut radically against the grain of the culture. Radically against the grain of the culture. I'm sure you have many, many friends. They look at you and say, God, you're on fire for justice. What's the problem? You say, what's the problem? Could you just listen to yourself? You're on fire for justice. I'm the problem? America itself is free and democratic precisely because there have been people in the past who were on fire for justice. You all know that. And America will remain free or democratic to the degree it is. Right now it's so oligarchic, still racist, sexist, homophobic, still anti-Semitic. A lot of people think, well, no, we're in the post-anti-Semitic period. No, that's not true. It's deeply anti-Arab. It's anti-Muslim, it's anti-children in its practice. We're not talking about what people talk about in abstract terms, you see. So that we want to have these discussions. I'm so glad to see the books outside. Because in order to be a long distance runner, you want to be able to commit yourself to reading voraciously, intensely, widely. Read on economics, on politics, but also read on culture, on music, architecture. And that doesn't mean you have to be an intellectual. It just means you want to be a decent, compassionate person who has a sense of what you're talking about. You know, a sense of reality. It's so easy to get caught up in the corporate, truncated media, where the very little sense of reality pierces through. Ideological to the core. Very narrow alternatives. Well, we have a report today on the Republican Party, and you sit there and say, oh my God, they're so mendacious, mediocre, and mean-spirited toward the poor. And the only alternative is the Democratic Party, and they're so milquetoast, spineless. Lack vision. Technocratic. Is that the only option we have? You can imagine why so many of our fellow citizens are addicted and self-medicated. Form of political pacification. Because oftentimes for them, that's the only alternatives they have, and they know both lack any serious substance. And I'm not saying, of course, that the two are identical. You know, but Brother Barack Obama, whoever he runs against, it could be Brother Romney, Brother Santorum, all three of them. Deep problem, Brother Barack. Better, Brother Barack, still subordinate to oligarchic rule. Still subordinate to corporate domination. Got to do better. And we have to be able to dialectically move inside of the system and support the Bernie Sanders and the Steve Cohens and Maxine Waters on a good day. Because she's... I heard her the other night talking about how wonderful Obama was. I talked to her just 2 weeks ago. She's saying what I'm saying. I said, Lord, Maxine, you're a politician, aren't you, girl? So I'm not a politician. I'm a free black man. I just try to speak the truth. I have no monopoly on truth, but I try to say what I really believe, not because I have to win an election or keep my job at Princeton, at Union Theological Seminary, where I'm going. I'll be coming in June and so forth. So it's not a matter of trashing politicians across the board, are being very candid about the fact that so much of our government especially Congress, and more White House, has legalized bribery and normalized corruption with the role of big money, the intervention of lobbyists bombarding them day in and day out, permanent political campaigns the very moment that they win, and therefore very little focus on public interest, common good, beginning with the weak and vulnerable, the children and the workers and others. I'm being very honest and candid about that. And oftentimes, of course, when you read those kind of texts and engage those kinds of arguments, it could be Noam Chomsky, it could be C. Wright Mills, it could be Francis Fox Pippen. Francis, was she here at this conference?
Yeah, right.
Ooh, you all got some high quality friends. Indeed, indeed. It could be Michael Harrington, it could be Manny Marable. I was just, you all recall Manny Marable, he just died, wrote the book on Malcolm X, the New York Times bestseller. Give Brother Manny a hand. Give Brother Manny a hand. We recall Brother Manny. I was just at Earlham College this Wednesday. He's a graduate of Earlham College with our precious Quaker and Mennonite brothers and sisters who've been such a light when it comes to bearing witness to social justice. And his mother died right after he died, about 3.5 weeks after he died. The man was from Dayton, Ohio. Earlham is in Richmond, Indiana. And his sister was there. It was a very moving moment for me because I knew Manny for almost 35 years, and it was a tribute memorial at his own undergraduate institution. But his works become very important in this regard. And again, it's not a matter of agreeing. I mean, you read Noam Chomsky, it's not a matter of agreeing with our visionary anarchic brother. He's an anarchist, and he's a critique of U.S. empire. It's not a matter of agreeing with every point. He's pushing you from the vantage point of those who are suffering. That's different than Brother Robert Kagan, the book that Barack is carrying around and promoting. Kagan's looking at the world from the vantage point of the powerful. The empire's in trouble. What we're going to do? We can't be in a real decline because we have to come up with ways of bouncing back. I'm quite explicitly pro-empire the way Neil Ferguson is. There's nothing wrong with reading Kagan and Ferguson. Just know where they're coming from. You want robust conversation. You want intellectual engagement. But you know where they're coming from. That's the crucial point. Intellectual dimension must be tied to the moral dimension. And here we have to talk about careers. The sad thing is that our universities and colleges have become sites of careerism and professionalism. And so the end and aim is primarily one of being smart, smart, smart. As soon as you enter college and university, the aim is what? I want to be the smartest in the room. Oh my God, how empty. How shallow. Nazis had smart people. Apartheid had smart people. White supremacy had a lot of smart. Male supremacy got a lot of smart people. Now, I'm not promoting stupidity here. But life is so much more, and you all know this better than I do, about being the smartest in the room. How do you connect your wisdom and critical intelligence to compassion? And most importantly, courage. And this is a challenge when you matriculate through the universities and colleges. There's not a premium placed on moral and political courage. You're smart in order to get a dynamite job to make big money and live in some vanilla suburb. You are successful. This organization is not just democratic socialists. Progressives across the board are preoccupied with being great, not just successful. And great is what is the quality of your service to others. Do you have the courage to really have compassion for those who are suffering? That's what greatness is. That's why all the folk I invoked, the Francis Fox Pippers and others, they may have been successful in terms of their academic careers. Brother Swartz successful in terms of his academic career. The brother is always focusing on greatness. How can I be of service? And most importantly, finding joy in doing that. Which means you always try to keep a smile on your face. Because if you don't find joy in doing it, you're not going to do it for too long. and you're living in a culture that's very much about the joyless quest for pleasure. A whole lot of bombardment of pleasure, titillation, stimulation, orgiastic foreplay. Bling, bling, G-string. Won't get into that on Sunday morning. You all know what I'm talking about. And there's nothing wrong with pleasure. I'm not a Puritan about these things. But if you can't find joy that's deeper than pleasure, you're not going to be sustained. Because you all know the instant gratification won't sustain you. No, not when your mother dies. Not when your friend goes to jail unfairly, prosecuted. Not when workers are pushed to the corner and folk losing their jobs or locked into part-time work. Got to find joy and some fun, and that deep sense of fun. You see, sense of play, so you can struggle in the most serious issues with a sense of a smile, as it were. And that's what's so wonderful about these gatherings, because we can, through solidarity, we can reinforce our intellectual and our moral commitments so that courage becomes more and more a fundamental and integral part of who you are. And you can't do it by yourself. It's impossible to do it by yourself. And I'll stop and we'll open up for questions on this last note. And this last note for me has to do with what it really means to be a blues person. What it really means to keep the track on the catastrophic. Because when you're a freedom fighter, intellectual freedom fighter, moral freedom fighter, what keeps you going is that you have the capacity of discerning and keeping track of the catastrophic, and it's very different than the mainstream. The mainstream, at best, keeps track of the problematic. Oh, we have a problem, and we got some problems to solve. Like the discourse in the 1830s with the mainstream. Yeah, we've got a slavery problem. No, you don't have a slavery problem. You have a catastrophe. Oh, we got a woman's problem. No, you don't have a woman's problem. You have catastrophe visited on sisters of all colors, dealing with domestic violence, dealing with forms of vicious discrimination, dealing with forms of attacks on their intelligence and their appearance and so forth. Oh, we have a worker's problem. No, 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 workers are dealing with the catastrophic. Now, of course, when the well-to-do have catastrophes like a few years ago, all of a sudden things get very socialistic. Isn't that fascinating? Working people call for help. Pull yourself up by your own bootstrap. Deal with the consequences of your actions. Put some responsibility, you know, that's how America operates. The banks get in trouble, pull yourself up by your own bootstraps, deal with the consequences of your actions, you fail, sorry, bye-bye. No, they call for help, they get help. From government, trillions of dollars, interest-free loans. Wouldn't that be something students had? Interest-free loans. Year after year after year after year after year. No, no, the blues is about catastrophe. Catastrophe, and I'm not just talking about phenotype. Yes, it's true, black folk, we introduced the blues idiom in the modern world. I got to smile because that's quite a contribution. It really is. And so this, like Jewish brothers and sisters gave the gift of prophetic conversation and witness to the world, Hebrew scripture, Amos and Isaiah and Micah. And so it's not that Jewish brothers and sisters always conform and practice to that, but the gift that they gave is magnificent. You got all these conversational partners. So Christianity and Islam and even our secular folk go back to Amos, Isaiah, Micah, and so forth. Historically inescapable to acknowledge that. Yet the blues idiom is, how do we deal with catastrophe in the present? With whatever form of domination or oppression it is. But the response to the catastrophic is always one of smile, style, intellectual reflection, and prophetic witness. That's why B.B. King, the King of the Blues, when he talks about nobody loves my mama, she might be jiving too. That's the blues. Strange fruit the southern trees bear that Billie Holiday sang about. The Jewish brother Maripol wrote the lyrics. That's America catastrophe. It's called American terrorism. They call that discrimination, segregation. No, it was American terrorism. Jim Crow. Just like we had Jack Crow in the 1940s. A wonderful new book by Matthew Briones, connecting in concentration camps by precious Japanese brothers and sisters. Subordinated. That was catastrophe. Got to get beyond the narrowly pragmatic for pragmatism and solve problems. And then we get to lie every January in the State of the Union. We are Americans. There is no problem we cannot solve. Uh-uh, that's not true. You're ignoring the catastrophic and there's some problems you still haven't solved. We need that for the myth to keep us going. No, no. We as democratic socialists and radicals are willing to tell the truth, and the condition of truth is to allow suffering to speak. We as democratic socialists, we have a compassion that begins with the least of these. And if we're not dealing with the least of these, then we've got to deodorize discourse. We want to keep it funky. The suffering, dealing with the mess, the underside, the night side of our societies and our world. That's what we will highlight and cast a light on. So I salute you in what you're doing, and I'm telling you, when we get together this time next year, it's gonna be a different world, a very different world. I know we've had a number of these magnificent gatherings over the years, and we're always trying to just, in some way, inspire folks so radically cutting against the grain, voices in the wilderness. More and more, we're no longer in the wilderness. People are looking at us, and believe me, you, when a nation reaches a conclusion that it fundamentally has the blues, then it turns to a blues people. And we got to be part of that leaven in the loaf. You see, who would have thought that at this particular moment, among your generation, the word capitalism has a negative connotation, and the word socialism, for the first time in decades, has a positive connotation. You ask them, what do they mean? They don't know. What do you mean by socialism? Well, I don't know, but I know it. I don't like this vampire vulture capitalism that's been at work. You're absolutely right. We're all going to connect. How do you connect that positive connotation of socialism to DSA? Or any of the other radical organizations. I know we got some SDS brothers and sisters here. Oh yes, no, I say God bless you. We got coalition, we wrestle with some issues. Absolutely. But what a moment, who would have thought? I didn't foresee this, Brother Joe. I don't know whether you, I know you got more foresight than I do. I just didn't foresee it. I figured we just go out swinging as voices in the wilderness. You know what I mean? But no, this is a new moment. And that's why I'm going to be standing alongside you all. Let me stop now and open it up, because we've got a good hour or so for conversation so I can learn and listen. But thank you so very much. Thank you so very much. We don't have time for theory. Jump right in. And we go back and forth. It doesn't have to be me responding, but others can respond to questions too. Thank you, Brother Abdul, for your wonderful artistic work, though, Brother, recording this, man. Give Brother Abdul a hand up. Absolutely. Very important. We get this all around the world. Questions or queries, though? Yes, my big brother.
What is it going to be necessary, particularly young black folks to really have a new sense of leadership in our community? Because it seems like everybody's pretty much been sold the community out.
Yeah, it's a wonderful question. One is that, as you know, we've got a historically specific situation in which the age of Obama is trying resulting in many ways of the relative silencing of the black radical tradition and the black prophetic tradition. And so those, especially in the black context, who are willing to be critical of Obama and wonder why Tim Geithner, does he represent the legacy of King? You got King's statue in your Oval Office. What does Geithner feel like when King's sitting there looking at him? And we ask Brother Barack. Brother Barack, I want to know. What do you think Martin is saying to your Treasury Secretary, the one you chose? What did Brother Martin say when my dear brother Larry Summers walked in the Oval Office. You'd think Larry should have felt a certain sense of indictment if he had intellectual honesty. But it's Barack who's making these decisions, right? Very difficult to say that publicly. Tavis Smiley, myself, and others have said it publicly. We get in a lot of trouble, that's fine. That goes with the territory. You know, things are going to shift slowly over time as the realities become more apparent. Because truth crushed to earth will rise again sooner or later. Sometimes it takes a long time. So I think that to the degree to which we have more and more young black folk willing to raise their voices explicitly, publicly, and working in three different levels. My attitude toward Barack Obama is one of wanting to protect, respect, and to correct him. I protect him against the vicious lies of, you know, Fox News, right wing, and so forth. They say, he's a Muslim. No, he's not a Muslim. He's a socialist. Hell no. A socialist? Take a look at this. This is what a socialist sounds like. Does he sound like that? Does he talk about those innocent folk that those bombs, that those drones are dropping on? Not a mumbling word. A little populist gesture here or there, but Wall Street has their men right there. Jacob Lew, Citigroup, crushing the union at NYU, and so forth and so on, you see. So Fox News telling vicious lies against him. And of course, I also pray for his safety because white supremacy is still alive. You got a lot of sick white brothers and sisters that want to kill him. And that's wrong. Even though I may politically disagree with the brother, I don't want him murdered by Ku Klux Klan or anything like that. It's just, so you're protecting that sense. I respect as a human being, even though I don't respect many of his policies. But then I correct, and I've been spending a lot of time on that one. I correct very strong criticism. But I think it's going to shift. Things are shifting. As you know, Steve Harvey and who was the other brother, Tom Joyner. Oh, Wes is an Uncle Tom. Uncle Tom, if I'm an Uncle Tom, I'm an Eskimo. I love Eskimos, but I'm not an Eskimo. I started life as a Negro and became a black man in the 60s, you know what I mean? So that those kind of lies, but those lies are powerful because these people have radio shows of 9 million black people. So that's a lot of people. And he meets with, they meet with Obama monthly. So there's deep connections. Same is true with my dear sister Melissa Harris Perry, who I've had dispatch with recently, you know. Al Sharpton used to be on the cutting edge with police brutality. Now he's hanging out with the mayor who initiated the policy in 2002, not a mumbling word from my dear brother Al Sharpton. You see what I mean? That's what it means to become well-adjusted to injustice, which is just a very bureaucratic way of saying selling out. That's basically what's happened. People want access, they want status, and they want to be part of what is popular at the moment. And in the black community, you can't be more popular than Barack Obama because it's a sign of success, not greatness. It's a sign of success. And I say Barack Obama is a fulfillment of King's dream. He's not the fulfillment of King's dream. He is part of the struggle for equal citizenship, rights, for legal and formal equality. That was a slice of King's dream. He is a fulfillment. But the fulfillment has to do with every poor person, person of every color, living a life of decency and dignity. That's what King's dream was. And we are so far from that, we don't even talk about it. See, but that's the kind of language we have to be very clear about. So you stay strong in being true to yourself, especially in the black context. I know you're not confining yourself to the black context, you're cosmopolitan, but that's a very important context. Because in the end, we're not going to have a social movement if black and brown and red folk are not integral to it. Have to. You want to make a point on this? Yes, jump in.
No, I was hoping to ask the last round question.
Oh, that's another question. Okay, go right ahead.
So, this is about the two axles and how.
Yes.
The DVD book, Discourse with the Two Axle, not the Two Axle, back title, teach people all that. Have to keep them.
That's right.
A lot of good things, but they don't like really do Yeah. What's the best way for like an intellectual to pass knowledge? Like, I don't want to like guide them. Like, to like give people like books or to like talk to them, like, oh, what this is. Do you have an answer to that?
Yeah, no, you all heard the question in the back. It had to do with different intellectuals, different kind of intellectuals, especially those who are not public intellectuals, political intellectuals, who might in fact talk and say wonderful things, but not often engage in action and practice and so on. And you see, I tend to be quite open to this thing. It's just, one, there's just a lot of different kind of people in the world. And I do believe there is such a thing as intellectual activism of people getting their work done, writing texts, providing insight and so forth. And a lot of those folk, you know, they just don't have a temperament to be politically engaged or publicly engaged. It's like certain musicians, you know, it's like trying to get Lester Young to lead a civil rights demonstration. He's gonna play the most beautiful music on the saxophone in conversation with a genius called Billie Holiday you've ever heard in your life, and you say, thank you, Lester, thank you for doing your homework and sounding so good. But John Coltrane is the one who's gonna show up with a saxophone at the mass demonstration, not Lester Young. Why? Lester Young gets a real shy kind of cat. He don't like to be around a lot of people. That's just the way he is. And certain intellectuals like that. So that even though somebody like myself, or Brother Joe, and others who are deeply politically and publicly engaged, I tend not to put down those intellectuals who are pursuing the truth. And we use their texts as a form of intellectual weaponry. But their temperament is such that they just don't like to be around a lot of folks. You know? They just like the library. Now, what happens is, unfortunately, the bulk of intellectuals, for me, are so tied into the prevailing paradigms. It could be neoliberal paradigms in economics. It could be behavioral paradigms in social sciences. Those are the dangerous ones. Because they're, for me, they're hiding and concealing the truth. And they have to be contested and combated. I wish there were more Francis Fox Pivots and others who both did the intellectual work and engaged politically. But that's a lot to ask. And we all do, we do need a division of labor, though, right? We need a division of labor. It's like last night at your party, right? If you were to say, I would like somebody to sing a song, everybody don't need to try to sing that song, because some of y'all can't sing. Some of y'all just can't sing, you know what I mean? Now, Sister Amy Winehouse come back from the dead and sing, let the sister sing. Because she has honed in on that craft. If Whitney want to come back, fine. Now, if it's karaoke, that's something else. But I'm talking about really singing. That's a certain kind of calling. You see what I mean? And some people who really sing well, that's basically all they do. Because life only got so much time. And I'm not saying this to in any way support passivity. You all see the point I'm making? There's a division of labor in this regard. And we have to be able, for example, a lot of those intellectuals, you bring them into these kind of meetings, and all of the work that they've done, they share it with you, then you all have the spring offensive, and they go back to the library. And you wish they were with you. It would be wonderful if they were with you, but their temperament is such they're just not going. And so I'm not justifying inactivity, but I am saying we want to recognize different kind of people in the world. You can be progressive in a lot of different kinds of ways. A lot of different kinds of ways. Some people who are painters, well, their image is going to play a fundamental role, but they got to take a whole lot of time to learn how to paint. So they can't engage in all of the activistic meetings and committee engagements, the kind of things that you all wonderfully, magnificently do. I know we got to move. Question, way in the back. Way in the back.
In your talk, you were speaking about the importance to make, you know, the Occupy movement hip to
yes.
the youth movement, while also rightfully reproaching, you know, popular culture for its stupidity and, you know, superficial consumerism. And other protest movements, like especially in the 60s, they were able to develop their own counterculture, you know, their own music, their own works of art, their own books. And so what I'm asking you is, what kind of steps should we take to go in that direction and sort of build our own culture that reflects our current values?
That was a wonderful question. Does anybody want to jump in on this, especially any social media people?
Without selling out, I mean, the counterculture became commodified and commercialized so quickly and became part of the dominant culture that we don't, you know, we want to affect the dominant culture without selling out.
And how do you think you do that? That's a tough one, though, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
I don't have the answer myself. But one thing you have to do is you have to create counter spaces, counter publics, because you don't want to be purist in the sense of thinking that somehow you will only create something counter if it will not be misunderstood, used, abused, and manipulated by the powers that be. You have to begin with the notion that everything you do, the powers that be will try to use and abuse it. That's a given. In the same way that when the movement really begins to escalate even more than it already has, one out of four folk in this room will be FBI. I always say, appreciate to have the FBI here. It's a compliment. It means we really on the move. We really on the move because the FBI is not keeping track of you. What does that mean? They figure you're not a threat. And that's a given. Because the powers that be are serious. Very serious. I mean, I've been living on death threat for 25 years. Shotguns in front of my house, put a gun to my wife's face. This ain't a plaything. These folks are serious. Martin Luther King Jr. found out what? His photographer was FBI informant from 1956 till the day he died. The brother who took all the pictures. One of his best friends calling FBI every day. We couldn't believe Brother Fox. My God, that's how serious they are. Brother Malcolm shot the first person there is the FBI agent before his wife gets there. This is gangster activity. But when you're a blues man or woman, you're dealing with the catastrophic, that is catastrophic. Still got a smile on your face, still got style, still got love in your heart, still got vision and analysis in your mind, and you're willing to live. And maybe for some, we'll have to die. So that the counter spaces that we're talking about, the counter spheres that we're talking about, we must continue to try to build them, but already know not only the infiltration, but manipulation by the powers that be. I saw a sign the other day, a Manhattan parking storage said, "Occupy us." Because they got empty space and they want people to buy space for their storage. See, that's just called, that's entrepreneurial creativity for advertising, rip off of one of the most important social movements in the last 50 years. That's going to continue on and on and on. So I don't have a direct answer. Does anybody else want to jump in on this? Yes.
I'm an actor, and that's my job.
Yes, wonderful.
I'm from Australia as well.
That's wonderful too.
I'm just being honest.
Yes, last night I got off the plane and went straight to see Death of a Salesman, one of the great towering figures, Arthur Miller, who I was blessed to know very well. I spent every summer with him in Roxbury, Connecticut. And you got Brother Philip Seymour Hoffman, who's a superb actor. Michael Nichols, directing, I ran into Brother Joe's nephew who was there, Brother Abe. And it's just such an Occupy spirit in the rendition of that production. Because it's very much about the emptiness of the American dream. It's very much about the 1% looking for recognition, looking to be liked, to be impressed, and so forth and so on. And you all know about Arthur Miller. He's one of the great freedom fighters, as well as one of the great artists who was courageous before the HUAC, the House on Un-American Activities Committee. He refused to give the names. Then later on, Mary Madeline Monroe, we won't get into that. But most importantly, you can see the counterculture seeping into not just the mainstream, but seeping into the mainstream that has already canonized certain powerful texts that come from progressives. So that all of a sudden you could see the people there. They would make these Occupy-like movement, 1% and so forth. But, oh my God, it's so relevant. You hear people talk, oh my God, it's so relevant, it's timeless. Like you go to bourgeois space, supposed to escape rather than engage. That's what they're used to. You see? So that all of a sudden now, this counterculture's back and forth, right? It's still mainstream. Broadway is about mainstream you can get, but Broadway got to deal with the Arthur Millers, the Sondheims, those critics of American society, even though they've been canonized. You can imagine they had a play by Mark Twain. Anti-imperialist to the core. Anti-racist to the core. Mark Twain's texts are becoming more and more popular. Because you're going back. John Steinbeck, going back, coming back with power. James Baldwin, we were talking about James Baldwin. Oh my God. Been dead since 1987. More relevant than ever. Other questions? I don't want to go on too long. Yes,
Mike. I was wondering if you could touch on maybe when you were growing up, if there was a spark that got you into activism. I understand that the climate is a lot different. Like our generation, mostly apathetic to a lot of it. And I think it takes a spark for everyone. If you could just talk about maybe the personal experience, what got you involved.
Yeah, I appreciate that question. See, I grew up in Sacramento, California. So there's sunshine land. Earth shakes and quakes a little bit, but it's sunshine land. And even though I was born in Tulsa, Oklahoma, but I didn't stay a few weeks. I'm basically a Californian to the core. I've worked 42 years, but I'm still Californian. And my Shiloh Baptist Church, which deeply shaped me along with my family, Cliff and Irene West, mom and dad. Dad is gone, mom's stronger than ever. Black Panther Party was right next door. So I was already deeply into Martin King. I heard King speak when I was 10 years old. See him right now as we just touch that brother, you see. And he just touched me so deep early on. Then the Black Panther Party right next door, I used to have long and deep conversations. Long and deep conversations about Franz Fanon, about Cabral, and just a whole host of anti-imperialist thinkers at the time. And I worked very closely with them. I couldn't join because as a Christian, they had a secular criteria. You had to be agnostic or atheist. And so we have to have these long discussions. You know, if you walk into Black Panther headquarters and they play Aretha Franklin, I say, turn her off. You say you don't want any church stuff. You don't know Aretha without the black church. You know that now. Put on Marvin Gaye off. Turn him off. Turn him off. He's right out of the black church. They go, dang, Brother West, who are we going to play? You're going to have trouble finding somebody. They're coming out introducing the institution that produced me in that regard. But I love my secular brothers and sisters, and they love me because we had a certain openness. I just couldn't join, but that was fine. I just worked in the breakfast program. And so when I went to college, we ran the breakfast program, we ran the prison program, and that became something that was consistent. I'm teaching in prison for 32 years. And I'm not working with the breakfast program anymore, but I'm still building on that. So it was more, like you say, it was a moment of social engagement, of social activism. And it was a King legacy, and especially the Black Panther Party, that shaped me. Even though I was, you can imagine, I'm open to Muslims like the great Malcolm X and a variety of others. But I started on the chocolate side of town. It wasn't until I actually went to college that I had a chance to really engage my white brothers and sisters politically and culturally and so forth, because we had deeply segregated conditions in those days. But it was a beautiful thing. Really, because once I had my ROOTS in place, then my ROUTES became more genuine and authentic. You know what I mean? Because you know, you run into black folk, love everybody but black folk. That's a key sweat moment. Something just ain't right. Or you run into white brothers and sisters, love everybody but white brothers and sisters. Or you gotta love your mama and grandma. Well, they got their races. Well, find something now. Because they constitute in part still who you are. Even your rebellion against them shows their influence. Because every critique is in part determined by the very object of your critique. You're fighting against your father, like Death of a Salesman. Biff fighting against Willie. But there's no Biff without Willie, so his very opposition and antagonism is shaped by the very person that he's fighting against. And there's elements of the person he's fighting against in his fight. It gets complicated, doesn't it? Deeply complicated. You see. sometimes you'd be more extreme just in order to make your point. But the point is probably determined by where your mom and dad were as a superego in your life, the authority in your life, you see. And so that's where what Antonio Gramsci called critical self-inventory is necessary. And all of us are unique individuals and creatures with our own birth, our own death, and our own fingerprints. And you have to be honest with yourself. What is your critical self-inventory that leads toward your awakening? That's why I love your question. We all have our own unique forms of awakening in that regard. And we learn from one another even as we have to wrestle with our own uniqueness and distinctiveness. Absolutely. Yes, question? Been on my mind really since the death, not just of Whitney Houston, but the death of Don Cornelius. Y'all know who Don Cornelius was?
Yes, sir.
Soul Train, 30 years. Don Cornelius, so he tried to sell Soul Train. They offered him a few million dollars. Robert Johnson sold BET, he got $3 billion 10 years ago. Now Soul Train had Curtis Mayfield, Stevie Wonder, Smokey Robinson, Sly Stone, Ohio Players, Main Ingredient, Confunction, James Brown. Can you compare that with what's on BET? The groups I talked about are Soul Stirrers, BET Body Stimulators, Thin Stuff, Bubblegum Stuff, billions of dollars. The deep stuff, Ashford and Simpson and others. Very little market value. Of course, one distinctive feature of being progressive is to say what? Human value, human life, never reducible to market price. So market price has little to do with what is really of great value. And hip-hop, when it took off, was still connected to a lot of the best of soul music. It really was, you know, so the Grandmaster Flash and Rakim and the others came right out of that, and the music that they deployed came right out of that. But then corporate domination came in, commodification, commercialization set in, next thing you know, you end up with bubblegum music. And I was just in the studio with Brother Ali. We did a thing together, we together on his new album, especially the first song. We spent a whole 4 or 5 hours, he came off and set up a whole studio. And we had a magnificent time. Mortal Technique, as you know, just came out with The Martyr, and I was blessed to do some things with him. So you do have counter voices. I mentioned Lupe, he comes to my class at least once a year. KRS-One as well. Trying to keep alive that counter space, counter culture we were talking about in the lingua franca of young people around the world, which is hip hop. And how do you engage the Jay-Z's? How do you engage the Kanye Wests and others. I was just with Rhymefest. You know, Rhymefest was the first hip-hop artist to run for office in Chicago. He ran against the Daily Machine. He started off 21. He was 21st in the list. He had about 28 of them running. We hit Chicago so strong. You know, Brother Rahm Emanuel had his roster, and boy, they were talking about Rhymefest and I like we were stepchildren. You know, West is an outsider, a foreigner. You know, I'm coming in from New York. I'm a foreigner, you know, in Chicago. But he made the runoffs with two. Scared the machine. That's fast. He scared the machine. And so again, of course he's working within the system, but he was bringing, you know, Lupe came in, raised big money, just like Lupe, as you know, provided some good money for the Occupy movement. Is that right? Give Brother Lupe a hand. That's Brother Consistent. Another Muslim brother, consistent in that regard. But it's a matter of ensuring that as the movement intensifies, the openness for the countercultural counter voices among the hip hop artists becomes stronger, because it's certainly there. We got to hit the vicious misogyny, hit the vicious homophobia, hit the vicious class arrogance and imperial arrogance and so on. And I think that is going to increase. I really do. Question in the back.
Grace and peace in Jesus Christ. Brother West, thanks for being here today. I couldn't be at the rest of the conference, but I had to leave my church without a drummer to be here with you this morning.
Give our brother a hand. Give our brother a hand. Appreciate it, though, brother. Definitely.
I'd like to make an observation and a question and just one point of information. I'm a singer-songwriter, and I tried to do something pretty practical relating to the Occupy movement. I wrote a song that's called 212-679-6018, and that's the Lawyers Guild number to call if you're arrested in New York City.
Oh, that's very useful. Very useful.
Thank you. It's on my website, guaguaelectrica.com. I'll give people cards if they want that. So you've really been a light for me as a Christian progressive. From very early on, my father shared your work with me. I feel, so my observation is, I've been meditating a lot on this phrase, you can't fight for a future that has no place for you. You can't fight for a future that has no place for you. And for me, one of the things that relates to is this traditional assumption among many progressives that progress, social progress, is equal to secularization. Mm-hmm. I think it's time to reject that as a Eurocentric bias. I think that might have been the narrative for Western Europe, but to assume that would be the same for the rest of the world isn't helpful. But there is this tension, and I'd love your thoughts on, one of the things that progressives and Democratic Socialists have often assumed we're fighting for is that the state should cover, the democratic state, the socialist democratic state, should cover more domain of society, increasingly more and more. For me, there is this tension between that and our current formulation of the separation of church and state. Mm-hmm. If you can't fight for a future that has no place for you, how does it make sense for religious people to fight for a future where the state would cover more territory? It seems that indicates some problem with that formulation, or maybe some problem with the state, or maybe my concepts of freedom. And I just think that it is true that in this country, when we've had big paradigm progressive shifts, people of faith have been welcomed into those coalitions. When you look at abolition or the civil rights movement or Eugene Debs movement. And I like
it. Yeah, no, appreciate that. You got a whole lot there on the table, my brother. Lord, I know there's some fascinating conversations about that, but we could have a seminar for weeks on all the different dimensions and aspects of the questions you raised. But I'll highlight this. One is that, for me, the major divide is not a religious and secular divide. The major divide for me is, first, philosophically, who takes life and death seriously, as opposed to just dealing with superficial issues. And who proceeds based on a profound love, commitment, and compassion for the weak and vulnerable. That's why I use the word prophetic in a broad sense. It can be prophetic in a secular sense, prophetic in Islamic, prophetic in Judaic, prophetic across the board, prophetic in Christian. What that means, of course, again, is when we couch it in that way, you're talking about a prophetic minority in whatever institution or movement you're talking about. So you got communists who are not prophetic, repressive and regimented. You got socialists who are. You got churches, Lord, yes, synagogues, temples, and so forth. Then you got a prophetic element of each one of those that's critical of the dominant forms. Constantinian Christianity tied to the empire. Constantinian Judaism tied to the empire. Constantinian liberalism tied to the empire. So it's a different way of looking rather than secular versus someone. So that's why you and I debate with late, great Christopher Hitchens. I love Christopher Hitchens. He's a brilliant brother. I love his sense of style on the page. He just is so religiously unmusical. He's tone deaf. He's flat-footed. And then his arrogance comes through. And so, especially when you're that smart, it's easy to be arrogant because there's enough stupidity around to make you think highly of yourself. You know what I mean? But I used to tell him that. The same would be true for religious folk who think they're so much better than agnostic and atheistic brothers and sisters. And of course, there you have to really get honest. I always tell my dear brother Bill Maher, well, the God I worship is not the one, the God you reject is not the one I worship. I reject that God too. Because he has a certain conception of God to be an atheist. See what I mean? Then he said, oh, Brother West, if you had a church, I'd be a member of that. Come on, brother, come on. But I'm not a preacher, I'm not a pastor, I'm not a minister, I'm just a crack vessel brother on the street. Saying what I got to say. I'm not called to be ordained in that sense, you see. So that the lens through which you view things are often very, very different than the more official perspective of secular versus religious and so forth and so on, you see. That last question that you raised was about the power of the state. You see, as a deep Democrat, I have a profound suspicion of the concentration of power in any sector. The problem in the United States, Lenin used to call it American society dictatorship of the bourgeoisie. He was writing at the turn of the century, during the robber baron age, between the 1895 and up until 1920. What did he mean by that? That capital was so powerful, they had bigger armies than the public army. Standard Oil and so forth. When he looked, he saw a society so profoundly shaped by capital that you needed the state as a counterbalance. But what I like about my anarchist brothers and sisters is they're concerned about concentration in the state. I don't have to be an anarchist to recognize that concern, because I am against concentration of power in the state. I don't want to keep track of what I'm doing in my bedroom or telling me I can't worship God this way and that way. That's why rights and liberties are so very, very, very important. But the question is, in your particular historical moment, how do you keep track of the various forms of highly concentrated power in the public sector and in the private sector? And so, in that sense, to be a deep Democrat is not to be tied solely into some narrow ideological commitment to the state or private sector or what have you. I actually believe that that social entrepreneurs can play an important role, because entrepreneurs are not the same thing as big capital or big banks. I think community banks are qualitatively different than J.P. Morgan Chase, qualitatively different than Citigroup. They're actually into lending. There once was a time when banks lended before Glass-Steagall, right? Not just trade. So that these kinds of distinctions, this is the beginning of the seminar that we're talking about, are very, very important. Very important indeed. And I appreciate your acknowledgement of the Christian element as well. But as you know, I mean, most Christians, you know, they trash me and I get canceled all the time. They invite me to Christian gatherings and so forth. My God, Professor West, I thought you were going to talk about the gospel. I said, I thought I was getting to the heart of it. What you talking about? And it's true, Jesus Christ, the country boy. The only time he goes into the city of Jerusalem, what does he do? He goes straight to the temple. What is the temple? The temple is a combination of Wall Street, government, and Hollywood. That's who was there. It's a concentration of cultural, political, and economic power. They had ceilings five times the size of human bodies. That's where he walked in. And what did he do? He ran out the money changers. You're not going to transform this house of prayer into a den of thieves. Hey, this brother's dangerous. Put the CIA on him. Put the FBI on him. And the very people who gave him a standing ovation Palm Sunday would turn on him and give us Barabbas, and he's going to die the life of a political insurrectionist. He died the life of a revolutionary. I don't argue that Jesus was revolutionary because you had slavery and he wasn't an abolitionist. He didn't say anything about slavery. That upsets me about Brother Jesus, but that's all right. He's got enough for me. He's got that love there. He's got that love at the center of it, no matter what. That prophetic Judaism, that hesed, that loving kindness that he wants to spread around no matter what, beginning with the weak, you see. But when you build on that particular tradition, which becomes a Christian tradition, no, Jesus was not a Christian. He was Jew and part of prophetic Judaism. But once another particular Jewish brother named Paul shifts from Saul, you got a movement beginning to get institutionalized, and you end up with a church, and the church is based on what? Judas's betrayal, Peter's denial, and Jesus' witness. What does that mean? You got a dangerous mix. Because you got some good stuff in there. You can keep track of the witness. But you got a lot of Judas in there too. And his legacy. And you got Peter. And Peter's the foundation of the church. And he was cowardly, didn't he? He denied three times. No, I don't know. I've never seen him. What are you talking about? Oh, didn't we see you hanging around with him? No, no, not me. No, somebody looked like me. Probably my cousin. But me. But you knew Jesus. No, 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 not at all. Somebody told me about him. I heard some decent things, but no. Peter, you're lying, man. You're scared. You're cowardly. It's human, though, isn't it? Brother Chris, wonderful work you do. Brother, you understand what I'm talking about. How do you keep track of the best, that prophetic element? Other questions? Yes, go right ahead.
It seems that, especially in the Lutheran movement, sometimes we have that Peter syndrome.
Yes.
We stand up and we say all these wonderful things, but then when the time comes for us to go, you know, march at Occupy and get arrested on the Brooklyn Bridge, we don't want to do it anymore.
Yeah.
We never heard about Occupy. We don't want to do it. Why is it there's that Peter syndrome even in the socialist movement today?
Yeah, it's a wonderful question, you know, brother. It's just a human thing that, you know, fears, insecurities, and anxieties result in having a certain special, I call it courage, a certain, how do you not eliminate fear, how do you work through and overcome fear so that you're willing to take a risk and pay a cost?
That's what the anarchists
do. You say what?
That's what the anarchists
do. That's what the anarchists,
that's what they're for.
That's what they're for? No, but my hunch is there's a tradition of cowardly anarchists too, though. I mean, it's a human thing. Anarchists are human too. Every tradition has a history of the great courageous ones. The rich tradition of courageous anarchists. I'd be the first to acknowledge that. But there's a tradition of cowardly anarchists too. Cowardly communists, cowardly Christians, cowardly atheists, and so forth and so on. I give lectures on black history. I always tell folks, you know, there's a long history of black cowards. Black frauds, black liars. That's part of the history, isn't it? Well, first, we didn't invite you to talk about that. We just want you to talk about the heroes. You can't understand the heroes without talking about when Martin Luther King Jr. tried to organize the churches in Montgomery. He got 12 churches out of 85. He said, we all talk about the 12, they were on the move. Oh, those Negroes were so courageous. What about the 73 that said, no, 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 not me, not me. I'm scared. That's a human thing. But when you have this moment, where more and more, you got over 700 people arrested on that bridge. Right over here. It's a different kind of moment. Because courage is contagious. It really is. Oh my God, I wasn't thinking about it. God, so-and-so getting arrested, they used to be cowardly like me. Maybe I need to step up. That's the momentum that we're building on. That's the momentum that we're building on, you see. Very much so. But of course, the next step is martyrdom. You see, we can't make martyrdom normative for social activists. You just can't. You know what I mean? I mean some of us willing to die, but that's not for everybody. You know what I mean? I mean, that we had that problem with slavery, right? Every slave who joined the insurrection was executed. You had over 250 of them. So when somebody has a plan, you ready to join? What are you telling them? You ready to die? Now, when Brother Martin used to meet with the young people in Alabama, you know the first thing he'd say to them? You got your cemetery clothes on? I got mine. Black folks said, this Negro's crazy. 18 years old, I'm not ready to die. But you're going to be a freedom rider. Scherner, Cheney, Martin was just being honest. Now that can't be the sole criteria. There's got to be some gradations and degrees prior to that where we can make a very important difference together, put pressure on the powers that be, and not expect everyone to either have to die or everyone to even get arrested. There's a role for the non-arrested activist. Very important role. But thank God those who are willing to get arrested do get arrested. Yes, go right ahead.
Yeah. So when you look at Occupy, you have, you know, there's we are the 99%, but then you take a look at it and it's mostly white, middle-class college kids. when you want that movement to spread and be universal, and you have this very strong, you know, martyrdom at the center of it, how do you really get that to spread? Because, you know, I look around here, it's almost like an Occupy crowd. So how do you really get that to move and be a universal movement across all really social spheres?
Well, one, I appreciate the question, but one is, of course, example. Very important for example, and when that example is tied to truth-telling and witness-bearing. You see, if there were a movement fundamentally concerned about corporate greed, fundamentally concerned about the racism of the new Jim Crow, and concerned about patriarchy and so forth, and if all of the first wave of members of that movement were from the east side of Manhattan, I would still rejoice. They're telling the truth. And when you tell the truth, it's not just a matter of your origin. You can get poor folks showing up behind the tea party. They're not telling the truth. You see what I mean? So I'm not downplaying your question. Your question is very important. Of course, by example, we need to broaden, put ourselves in the shoes of, in the context of other poor persons and what their various issues are. For example, I mentioned police brutality. That's an issue that is lived among many poor black and brown. That's not the case among middle class white. It's just a different attitude toward the police. And you have to immerse yourself in that experience of brown and black poor people to have a sense of why they have this reaction toward the police, stop and frisk, humiliation, and so forth and so on. And when we got arrested, it was a colorful affair. You know, we, and the police, they were colorful too, because you got black, brown, and white police. And when they put us in the paddy wagon and so forth, they saw all these different colors. When we went to jail, we started singing Motown songs, and the police joined with us. Because you had a cultural connection. Because we were in Harlem. And we're telling them, all you all are workers too. With you, but you also being used by the state to do us in, man. Well, I see what you're saying. Let me think about that. I'm praying for you, man. Broadening the issue. Same is true in terms of the children. Right? The children don't have to be part of the movement for us to talk about it. And for the most part, we get more and more young people. I'm talking about the real young children. You know, who really advocates and lobbies for children between 0 and 6? Marion Red Elton and a few others, that's it. That's it. Well, we have to be able to have that. That's where empathy comes in. So yes, we do have to expand. But one thing I do want to say, and I've been blessed now to be in a number of different Occupy sites, because each place I lecture, I always stop at the Occupy site. And I do see a significant number of people of color in these sites. Not majority by any means, and it's not reflecting the percentages of the larger population, so I'm still with you in that regard. But I do see a significant number of peoples of color, and that's important. We met with the Peoples of Color Caucus in Occupy Oakland, where we had a lot of tension and friction and so forth, and that was very, very helpful for each and every one of us across the board. But it's you don't know, these are uneven developments. You don't know how it's going to unfold. You just don't know. But what you must have bridge figures. You see, we got to have brown brothers and sisters who are rooted in the community, know, for example, that these racist immigration policies impinge directly, immediately, on the lives of our precious Latinos, especially. But then at the same time, connected to the corporate greed and the other kinds of themes and motifs that we get from Occupy Wall Street and other places that are not necessarily rooted in brown realities. But in the end, we're gonna have to work together, stay together, struggle together, swing the way Ella Fitzgerald and Muhammad Ali taught us to swing. Don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing in it. Political form of swing. Yes, my dear man.
What really frightens me these days is the, you know, subversively racist language of the GOP. And when I try to, like, talk to people about it, they call me too sensitive to issues of race. Funny, right? So I was curious, how can we perhaps further expose this language for what it is, which is overtly racist, and language and policies.
Absolutely. I think one thing we need to do, there's a book that's very important for all of us to read and reread by an early DSAer, our dear brother Robert LaCotra. He wrote the best book on Reaganomics called Greed Is Not Enough, 1982. Why is that so? He speaks specifically about the racist character of the language coming out of Reaganism. Because what you're getting from Santorum and Gingrich and others is just rebate Reaganite language that was tied to overt and covert white supremacist discourse about black people, poor people, especially black women, and so forth. So you get it recycled. So to have that historical sensibility, keep track of the genealogy of the discourse, the language, even when it's misogynist and homophobic and so forth, and you can see the attempt to recuperate, because what we're experiencing now is the last gasp, we hope, of what was a glorious age for the 1% and the well-to-do, which is the last 30 years, where Reagan, of course, is the hero. And keep in mind, Reagan did what? Opposed civil rights bill, opposed voting rights bill, opposed open housing. He said, God, how could somebody like that become a hero? Because they ignore it. He's behind Goldwater. What did Martin Luther King Jr. say about Goldwater? The most dangerous political candidate in his lifetime. What did Goldwater say about Martin King? I can't say it in public. That's the same movement. That's what Gingrich and Santorum going about. So you keep bearing witness and, you know, demythologizing and deconstructing the overt and covert racism. But just know it does have that history. But see, in the age of Occupy, there is a hysteria on behalf of conservative and reactionary forces. They're really scared. And they're scared because of you all. That's a compliment to you, I'm telling you. Brother Joe and I haven't been able to make them scared in the last 30 years. Yeah, go right ahead.
You were talking earlier about Jesus, and as we all know, most of what Jesus preached is a lot of what we are advocating for, like helping the poor and so on and so forth. But, you know, nowadays the sort of church establishment is kind of, you know, co-opted with the Republican Party.
Oh, yeah.
I was just kind of wondering what your thoughts were on that phenomenon.
Oh, no, appreciate the question. But keep in mind, of course, what I'm suggesting is not just nowadays. It started from the very beginning. From the very beginning. Right? Christianity began among persecuted Jews. Then it reached out to Gentiles. Brought in some Goyim, you know. Then the Goyim come in, take over. So you go from persecution in the lion's den to the courts of the empire early on. And that's been the history of the church. The prophetic ones tied to the kind of witness that's a threat and those who accommodate themselves. So if we were here in, you know, in New York City in 1830, what do you think most of the Christian churches were when it came to white supremacist slavery? Accommodating. Same is true. Market-driven capitalism tied to imperial power. Most of the Christian churches accommodating. So you get prosperity gospel, market-driven society. Market spirituality in a market society. You see? Blessings in the form of commodities, Lexus, whatever it is, in a society in which commodification is central. And it's only those who are willing to go against. So in that sense, it's not just our day, but a particular form. And yet at the same time, to go back to my brother who raised the question, who was kind enough to leave his church and leave that church without a drummer. That's a big move in my church, you know that, Tom. It's a black church without a drummer, oh my God. The preacher can't preach right. But those prophetic religious folk, especially in the United States, have played a very important role. The abolitionists began with the prophetic Christians. Prophetic Jews, and then later on the 60s, prophetic Baptists and Christians and Jews, Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel, who I invoke all the time, fundamental in this regard. Brother Michael Lerner now, crucial in this regard. He's not by himself. But again, they're a slice. They're a slice. You know, he's not APEC. Now, APEC has a whole lot of deeply religious Jewish brothers and sisters, right? APEC, what is your critique of empire? Null said. We support the empire explicitly. And then they generate their arguments, and you determine whether they're whether they are you know, successful in their arguments or not. There's an element of truth in what they say in terms of the need for security of our precious Jewish brothers and sisters. But that can never, ever downplay the need for justice for our precious Palestinian brothers and sisters. So the question becomes, even as a prophetic person or whatever religion or secular tradition, how are you committed to truth and justice in such a way that it might be very painful to have to deal with this challenge, but at the same time, the need for those basic concerns like security among Jews, 2,000 years of vicious hatred and pogroms and Shoah and Holocaust and so on, and yet at the same time, if you jump out of the burning buildings of Europe and land on the backs of Arabs, you have a choice. You coexist or you dominate. Which one are you going to do? When you look at the history of Jewish discourse of that day, prophetic Jews were saying coexist. Deeply conservative ones saying dominate. The conservative ones triumphed. 67, occupation. Form of domination. Prophetic Jews, critical of the occupation. Conservative Jews, this is the only way we can survive. Nobody cares for us. We're in the world all by ourselves, and it's nice to have the U.S. Empire as a support. So, what would Amos say? What would Micah say? Well, he was back then. This is a new situation now. Now, traditions matter. You see what I mean? Traditions matter. Yes.
I feel that a lot of the apathy of our generation has to do not just with commodity fetishism, because it's been around for a while, but specifically technological fetishism. And I was just wondering how we like that.
That's a fascinating point. Does anybody want to say a word about that? I like that point. I've never had a computer, so I'm not really a part of that. But I do hear. You want to jump in on this? But see, I think this brother's point is, tell me whether I'm right or not, is that even if technological fetishism and commodity fetishism are inseparable, they're not identical. So then the question becomes, what is the specificity of technological fetishism? Even though you accept his point, though, right? The two are tied together. But what is it? What is the specificity of it? Because if, in fact, and I think there is something about the notion of when Marx talked about the fetishizing, the ascribing magical powers to commodities, the ascribing the magical powers to technological entities is very real. It's partly because it is mind-boggling on a certain level that you can just have a cell phone and talk to somebody in Shanghai 2 seconds from now. It's like, dang, this is something else. So you figure there must be some tremendous power there that you're willing to bow down to. Now, of course, you can't get the cell phone unless you buy it or you win it in the lotto or something. But in that sense, they're inseparable. But how do we get at that specificity of it, which was not the case 200 years ago, to the same degree? Is that a fair question, you all? Anybody want to take a stab at that? Brother Joe, jump in anytime you want to, brother. Get in there. Brother, right behind you.
So I think, well, it's true that technology in general it started certainly as a full broad thing. It's sort of become a little more broad now. But I think that we shouldn't discount from that that the internet is hugely powerful as an activist space, among other things. Like, certainly there are the bits that are somewhat murky. There's 4chan, there's Reddit. But within that, there's, even within those communities, there are huge protest movements that started up. It was people on the internet that defeated ACTA and SOPA and PIPA, who it was so, which were all basically corporate cronyism bills, and well, ACTA was a treaty, but that's beside the point. So the internet is a hugely powerful activist space, and I think discounting it because it's connected by association with the bourgeoisie, well, certainly it shouldn't be connected. It shouldn't be exclusive to the bourgeoisie. It shouldn't be as connected to the bourgeoisie. Dismissing it because of that, I feel, would be a waste.
No, I think we do want to agree that it can certainly be a site for progressive thought, progressive action, and so forth and so on. But ways in which it might also be tied into sleepwalking, pacification, and so on. Yeah, do you want to jump right in?
And I think part of the technology question has to do with empire. Mm.
Can you hear him in the back?
This next question will probably have to be our last.
Was that right, dude? Because we're supposed to end about 12 o'clock? Yeah. We might get to it if I can shut my mouth.
So, some of the historical victories in the United States, when you're talking about active movements, are fighting specific goals. You're talking about women's rights, so right to vote, or civil rights. Now it seems we've moved into activism of the abstract, which seems harder because you're fighting large-scale problems like global warming or just capitalism, which always haven't been very successful. How do you fight the abstract rather than specific ideas?
That's a good one. One last question, and then have we had good gender balance in our questions? Have the sisters had a chance to voice it? Any sisters? We have two sisters if you want to. Yes, jump right in.
I find most of the problems that I see, obviously they affect masses, and like that's why we're all here, because we care about humanity and people in general.
Mm-hmm.
But how would you come up with a way to not attack but persuade people on a personal level, like individually, to think about themselves morally and ethically, to then treat one another in a compassionate way so that they can look at the entire group in like a non-biased way to then make better.
That's a deep and tied to this crucial question about the abstract. There's one last sister who wants to raise a question. Yes.
I guess my question is sort of the education system in this country is one of the most appalling failures on so many levels.
Oh, that's so true.
But I have a lot of difficulty trying to think of what any one of us personally can do to try and address that catastrophe. And I mean, in a lot of our universities, I'm sure there's programs like Teach for America, but that always, I personally see that program as deeply paternalistic and kind of problematic in that sense of just like parachuting middle class kids into communities for 2 years and somehow that'll solve the problem. So I just wondered what your thoughts on education.
Oh yeah, good God Almighty. Hey, I'm going to answer all three, and you all let me know whether you think that it has any adequacy, my response has any adequacy. One is that, I do believe we can always do something. We can always do something. That is to say that we can touch lives, and each life is very precious. So that even, for example, it's not revolutionary, it's not even that reformist, but just mentoring makes a difference. If you have a precious young person and you change their life, and you convince them that they're worthwhile. They can, the sky, if not the limit, is something they can look up to rather than just locked into the self-disrespect and so forth. That makes a difference, really. What we want is revolution. Because I am a revolutionary in that sense. See? And when I think of, you know, what we are, what's going on today, is I look at the history of America. We began, other than that vicious genocidal attack on our precious indigenous brothers and sisters, and the enslavement of Africans, and the subordination of white working men who couldn't vote, of course, with the U.S. Constitution, had their property in order to vote, and then overlooking, you know, the vast majority of people in the society who are sisters of all colors, the women, that the first major revolutionary energy was against the monarchy. And I'm an anti-imperialist, even with George Washington, who's a slaveholder. I'm an anti-imperialist. So I view that struggle against the British Empire as very important, even though subordination of indigenous peoples and so forth was ugly. In the same way I'm with Winston Churchill. I'm an anti-fascist. He was against Hitler, gangster, but he's an imperialist to the core and racist to the core. I'm not with Winston on that. But we together, we got a united front against Hitler. He's going to dominate the world. So that's a hell of a coalition, isn't it? Anti-racist, anti-imperialist, with Winston Churchill. Oh my God, yeah, that's how bad things work. The second wave was against slavery. The second revolution in the country was against slavery. And it took, unfortunately, Civil War, 200,000 black soldiers to join the Union Army to break the back, the Confederate Army. We're living now in the moment, because Martin King and others were just dealing with slavery by another name, right? Jim Crow, Jane Crow. It took 100 years for that revolution to be complete. Now is our moment of oligarchy. We've gone from monarchy, slavery, now it's oligarchy. And we can make it less abstract if we really unpack oligarchic rule, oligarchic power in the cultural sphere, military-industrial complex, politics, educational system, and so on. So that it does in some ways make it more difficult, but we can generate demands in light of this call for a new revolution. I think that's what Martin King was talking about. He was talking about the poor here and in the critique of imperial power with oligarchs, in fact, ruling there. And Brother Tabitha Smiley and I just finished a text, actually just last night in Fresno, called The Rich and the Rest of Us, a Poverty Manifesto. It'll be out in April, and we're going to hit the ground running precisely on this issue. Precisely on this issue. And it connects with education because if we're suspicious of the forms of education that make people accommodating to oligarchic rule, then we need some different frameworks and paradigms in order to keep track of the way in which 1%, the way in which plutocrats at the top would like us to engage in cheap schooling rather than deep education. Just school yourself to join our way in which we construct society. No, we got deep education here. And what's fascinating there is we can actually get some help from some of the great figures of the past. Ancient, medieval, as well as modern. You see, because they were critical of oligarchic rule. You know, Beethoven's Ninth, what was that about? It was a critique of the Congress of 1815. That's why he ended with Schiller. Who was Schiller? The critic against the police state. The critic against repression. And so forth. You see, Beethoven's Ninth, that's the height of bourgeois culture. Understand who Ludwig was. He started a supporter of Napoleon, rejects him when Napoleon becomes an emperor. Writes him off the page in the fifth, in the third, and so forth. And I'm just talking about the height to the height. We haven't even gotten on down to some more popular artists in this regard, you see. And so when it comes to our education, it's not just the revolutionary artists, but you've got some bourgeois artists who were very, very critical of oligarchy, of slavery, of monarchy, but they may not have been socialists. We don't know what Beethoven was. He was Ludwig. That's who he was, genius and so a lot of things. Same would be true. Poetry of Muriel Rukeyser, one of the greatest poets of the 20th century. Who reads Muriel Rukeyser these days? Everybody ought to read The Life of Poetry in 1941, read Speed of Darkness in 1968. There's no Adrienne Rich, there's no Alice Walker without their teacher, Muriel Rukeyser, building on Whitman, critical of oligarchy and the ways in which it's connected to patriarchy. She's part of this new wave. That's why Democracy Matters, I spent so much time with Muriel. Because she's poor. But that's part of the educational challenge that we have. And for you all to be able to live in this moment, oligarchy in all of its various forms, plutocracy in all of its various forms, a now something to be interrogated in light of very deep democratic sensibilities, but we're talking about transfer of power. That's what revolutions are. And now the King legacy is peaceful and nonviolent and so forth, but the violence is already here. And the question is, how do you respond in such a way to get some transfer of power to working people, to ordinary people? That one last point, that second question, where is my dear sister? Raise that question. Your question again was about oh, the compassion and empathy.
Right.
Yeah, that's right, because I forgot about that. Absolutely. Well, I think, again, it's primarily by example. It's primarily by example, you see, that the cycle of apathy and complacency is interrupted. Yeah, I have a notion of utopian interruption. Utopian rupture from the routine, the so-called normal, the common sense, to use Gramsci's language. And how do you shatter that? First by example, then by organizing and mobilizing, and then creating a new kind of, a new normal that's progressive and prophetic, a new sense of common sense where everybody assumes that oligarchs ought not to rule. You see? And of course, that's what, that's what we're able to sit here right now in this wonderful space. And that's what folks did before, right? 150 years ago, the norm was what? Black folks so-and-so, women so-and-so. No, we created new common sense. Negroes are human. Oh my God, that's a new idea. I never thought about that. It's revolutionary, subversive. That's right. Black people are human just like everybody else. That's what Malcolm X said and got in trouble. Y'all remember that moment Johnny Carson showed Johnny? Malcolm, what do you think about the Negro problem? He said, Negro problem? What is that? What does the Negro really want then, Malcolm? What do they want? What you want, though, Brother John? They want the kids to be treated decently. They want neighborhoods that are safe. They want schools of quality. They want jobs with a living wage. They want to raise their voices in terms of self-determination. What do you want, Johnny? Well, that's what I want. Then what is the problem? Then he looked him right in the face. He said, Johnny, I'm the man you think you are. And Johnny said, can we go to a commercial, please? Things get hot. Things get hot. But that's important. What we're doing now in regard to oligarchy. Thank you all so very much. Thank you. I salute you. I salute the work you're doing. We're going to stay together. We're going to stay together on this thing.